Hi everybody, I hope you can hear me. Today is Wednesday, 5:30 p.m. and thanks for attending our webinar. Elliot Bogart here. I'm a president of Broadway Realty, New York City based real estate company. And I would like to welcome you to this panel. Hope all of you are doing fine during this not easy times of crisis. COVID-19 is still here. Hopefully in a couple of weeks we will be going through this crisis, and I hope everybody's healthy and safe. So it will bring us to our subject. I'd like to welcome you and to tell you all about what's going on now. Probably most of you would like to know what's happening now in real estate. And so real estate now is going through the COVID stages as well. And we have buyers and sellers who are wondering what is going on and what is happening in today's New York real estate. Our webinar is called Real Estate in a Changed World. So first, there is a lot of economists. Nobody has a crystal ball, unfortunately. As Warren Buffett said in his 89 years old life, he did not see any crisis of this significance. And so we can only think. But the U.S. unemployment rate, as we know, it is stunning, and the numbers are now the highest in a few months period now. A lot of people unemployed. It's never been like this. But the prediction is the U.S. unemployment rate will fall, and it will fall by the year end. About 8.7%. So in the return to a more typical level in the 4% range by 2023, which is about 3 years from now. Recovery timeframes for U.S. leasing volume by sector are about 3 years for retail. Retail is hurt the most. 2 years for office, and 1 year for industrial real estate. Residential real estate is also hurt a lot, and I would like to take this. We will talk about the residential real estate later, and I'll tell you all about my thoughts about residential. Canada is projected to lead the G7 economies with GDP annual growth rate of 9.5%, followed by UK by 6.2%. And the Larry Kudlow said the third quarter of the year could be the fastest growing quarter in the U.S. history as America steps out of the crisis. We're all anxious and itching to start working and to get back to normal life. With the retail sales down more than 16% last month, the unemployment rate up where it hasn't been since the Great Depression, and so much uncertainty about what will happen as states reopen their economy. Could that be true? And that's who answers this is the Megan Green, a senior fellow at Harvard Kennedy School, will help with the answer. So he said, I think that as the economy opens up, we should see the economic data improve. Depending on how you are looking at that data, it will either improve a little or it will improve a lot. So it's uncertainty there too. A quarterly economic growth, the increase in gross domestic product is typically expressed as a percentage. For example, in Congressional Budget Office predicts there could be a 5.4% increase in GDP in the quarterly GDP the third quarter of 2020. However, that will be a percentage increase from the second quarter of this year, which is widely expected to be one of the worst in US history. We can feel it and we can see that the stores have been closed, all the economic sectors are shut down. Real estate, as we know it as well, we'll talk about it, but it's hurt a lot. And no transaction or very little transaction happened in March and April this year. So the next quarter compared to this one will look really good because it's compared to a really bad quarter. Green said that what we need to do is compare where we are right now to where we were before this crisis even started. The community house improvement program, which represents around 4,000 landlords of rent stabilized apartment buildings, said this week that among its members who also have commercial tenants, two-thirds of those tenants did not pay rent in April and May. So the last 2 months, two-thirds of the tenants are not paying. And that's landlord's most concern nowadays, to collect the rents, of course, from the tenants. Nearly 25% of its members, residential tenants, did not pay rent in May, up from about 20% in April, the group said. Before the pandemic, the figure was around 15% in a given month, said the group, whose members it surveyed collectively own more than 100,000 rental units in the city. So that's what landlords are facing now. Many people not paying rent because many buildings are not occupied fully. Many people moved to their second home, they rented countryside houses, many buildings are occupied 30-40%. That's what we know in New York and Manhattan. So Varnada Realty Trust, one of the city's biggest commercial landlords, said that nearly all its retail clients, with the exception of grocery stores and other essential businesses, have sought financial relief, such as deferral of rent payments. Many of them asking to get at least partial discounts of rents. And now it brings us to five biggest mistakes real estate owners must avoid during COVID-19. Before we started on those five biggest mistakes, I would like to mention that Manhattan real estate in the springtime, as always, a busy season for us. We did not see that season. The market didn't open for us, so people tend to look at the apartments. We get a lot of inquiries. We have a lot of people interested to look, but we cannot show apartments. So that's the reason and the main problem why the transactions are not happening. People who buy apartments for $1-2 million, townhouses, $5-10 million townhouses, they would like to look at the properties, not just the virtual tours. Even though they would like to see virtual tours, they're looking at those and they patiently waiting until the market will open. So that's what we're waiting for. So, and mistakes are as follow: underestimating the cost of selling. In New York City today, to sell a property, it will cost you about 5-6% for the broker's commission, and the total cost of selling a home can amount more than 5-6% because of the, when you account to closing costs, repairs, and other concessions to the buyer, the cost of selling can be closer to 10% of the sales price. So every property owner, every seller, before making this decision, they have to calculate and know exactly what it will cost them to sell the property in today's market. Next is setting an unrealistic price. That's also very important to know how much is your property cost. You have to know all the comps, and today comps in your particular building in your area might not be your current comps. It might take you to look at comps that are 6 to 12 months prior to today's market, because not many sales happened this year. So the price you want and what the market will pay can be two different things. You might hear the term fair market value, which refers to how a home is valued when both the buyer and seller are reasonably knowledgeable about the property and neither is under any pressure to buy or sell. So it's always the dialogue between the buyer and seller, and the market will show the real price, what a buyer is willing to pay and what seller is willing to accept. Only considering the highest offer is a mistake, and that's a mistake that needs to be avoided. You have to know all the offers out there, because the highest offer, while exciting, isn't always the best offer given your needs. It's a common in many traditional sales to have contingencies. These are contingencies must be satisfied for the sale to close. You may have contingencies that protect the buyer's interests, like financing contingency or inspection contingency, that might not turn to sale. And you have to be really careful and to know that the contingencies might break the sale. And if you putting property into hard contract, you have to know exactly that it will close. If you take property off the market, you better know that this is a hard contract and you guaranteed to sell it. Next one is ignoring major repairs and making costly renovations. It's always important in any market, especially in this fragile market, that a long list of maintenance issues can turn buyers off and potentially decrease the value of the home. More importantly, buyers expect the conditions of your home to match the description. Consider prioritizing the most glaring issues, particularly those that are likely to turn up during a home inspection. Many buyers will require an inspection before closing. So of course, I always recommend to stage an apartment to make it to look really nice. If it's a townhouse, it must be immaculate. You have to spend time and prepare the house for sale. That's really important. Okay, that takes us to the next question, which is choosing a wrong agent or a wrong way to sell. If you choose to work with a real estate agent, make sure you select an agent who has your best interests at heart. According to realtor.com, some agents charge a flat fee. Yes, there is such a thing as a flat fee for sale, while others charge a percentage of the sales price, usually 5-6%. In Manhattan, 5-6% is a lot of money, but sometimes it's worth for sellers to pay. So sellers, of course, can negotiate the commission, and I always suggest to do that when you talk to your agent, and agents, they are negotiable. They negotiate all day, every day, so they will negotiate their commission as well. So next one is to help ensure you are getting the most bang for your buck, take the time to interview potential real estate agents, talk to different agents, check their licensing and credentials, talk with past clients, and make sure they have plenty of experience selling in your particular area and price point. So you may want to hire a building specialist, somebody who's very knowledgeable and who knows your building well. He might have some inventory that he's selling, and he can have some buyers that are on the market. So you'd like to talk to this agent before you hiring somebody. You may also ask potential agents about their marketing plan for your home, whether they require you to sign a contract with them, and of how, for how long, the negotiation style, how often they plan to communicate with you, if they have a current listings that might compete with yours. That's also important. That is bringing us to 7 popular misconceptions about marketing your property after COVID-19. And that's for both, for buyers and sellers. There are some mistakes that buyers make as well as sellers. So it's very important that COVID-19 changed the market, and for a couple of months, you cannot see the property, but still you might want to get on a good deal, and you want to make that COVID deal and to buy or sell the property now. So this is a point to consider. Keep in close contact with your realtor and lender to keep tabs on industry reaction to the pandemic. Make sure that they are and you are allowing recommended COVID-19 protocols. Be understanding if your agent declines your request to visit properties during this pandemic, and respect the personal decisions regarding the health and welfare of themselves and their family. So sometimes agents say, and they are right, even to make a video of the property, you have to enter somebody's home and to make that video and to make that tour. So it takes you have to be considerable. Consider the many pros and cons of physically visiting homes in person at this crucial time in your world's history. Seriously consider screening homes by requesting online tours in lieu of personal appointments. If you find a home you'd like to see that doesn't have a tour posted, ask your agent to inquire if the listing agent is willing to encourage the sellers to film a tour on their phones to pass along for your initial screening. So sometimes you have an occupied residency, a condo that is occupied by tenant or house, and the tenant is nice enough to make that film or video tour. We had a situation where a tenant did it for us. Vacant houses, of course, are much easier. You can do a tour and send it to your client. So that helps a lot. Talk with your realtor about the pros and cons of making offers on properties you've seen virtually, but not in person. Get familiar with contingencies that could protect you and amendments addressing the ramification of purchasing during the COVID crisis. You have to communicate with your realtor, of course, and discuss all these possibilities. That brings us to next. Understand that delays in closing timelines may be inevitable. Talk to your lender about any situations you are facing that may impact your purchase, including any temporary layoffs or change in financial situation. Don't worry. Consider the pros and cons moving forward with your purchase plans in light of world economic changes. Look for the silver lining, like historically low interest rates and less buyer competition. We never had interest rates that low. Today, we had an offer for 2.25% interest rate on an interest-only mortgage. I was surprised the client received such a great mortgage quote. And the mortgage rates are not expected to go any higher anytime soon. So it's a great time to lock into good rates today. What were home sellers and real estate brokers doing to sell a house, condo, when social distancing rules made in-person visits impossible? Over the past few years, even before the coronavirus, real estate brokers have increasingly been integrating the use of technological tools into the sales of homes. So a lot of us using technology such as 3D virtual tours. So examples include online listings, virtual presentations for attracting prospective clients, such as following for new listings, remote virtual tours, direct interaction using two-way real-time audiovisual technology such as Zoom, Skype, and FaceTime, electronic execution and delivery of documents. Many brokers were able to apply these tools to facilitate transactions after social distancing rules went to the effect. How does COVID-19 pandemic create new legal risks for home sellers and real estate brokers? The buyer may not have sufficient time to satisfy their lender's financing requirements. The buyer may have lost their job due to the pandemic. Lender guideline changes based on credit scores leading to the denial of mortgage. The buyer may have suffered a steep decline in the net worth due to the recent sharp decline in the stock market. Thank God stock market is back to normal, but it's still a possibility that many people lost money in the stock market and had a margin calls and things like that. So the house might not appraise for the purchase price value depending upon how the real estate market reacts to the ongoing crisis. So the appraisal is a new, they also in a new challenging world now because of the number of transactions and banks taking new risks. So the appraisals will be also, that's an industry that has changes and appraisals are happening. We had Citibank, HSBC, Bank of America appraisals done recently, and they are happening and they are getting values, pre-COVID values, so they are happening. So the next point is, are we in recession or a depression? I hear a lot of people asking those questions and how each would affect the housing market. So, and this is of course very important question. So my thoughts are as follow. The nation's current suffering may resemble a depression more than a recession because we are in a lockdown, but just how prolonged the plan is will likely be deciding factor. So unfortunately, no one knows how long it will take for the nation to regain its economic footing, and all of us we would like it to be a short and fast recovery, and we all will participate and we would like it to be happening as soon as possible, and we hope we are in a recession and it will bring the economy to new heights. And I heard today Anthony Malkin, the owner of Empire State Building, he was discussing all his things that's happening with the Empire State Building, all his office tenants, retail tenants. And so he has a lot of things happening. And so he is saying, and he is very positive that New York needs it will have a phase one, phase two, and phase three, and people crave New York City, so they will come back, and New York is always recovering, and so he's saying that meetings are matter, and the social distancing will not be for long, so as long as and soon, hopefully, we will have a vaccine that will, of course, will help the situation. But we have infrastructure in New York that depends on a human interaction. And so meetings are part of the creative process. People need people. people need meeting places, people need businesses to be open, the stores, the restaurants. That's what we, of course, looking forward. So hopefully next our webinar will be in a different market, and I wish you all the best in real estate. And if you'd like to get in touch with me, please let me know, email me. I'll be happy to answer any questions. I will do Q&A session, and it will be a free Q&A. I still have my book, Get Rich in Real Estate. It's all updated and new. It's available on Amazon. If you'd like to look at it, read about it. There's some reviews available on Barnes & Noble, on Amazon, and on Audible. So good luck, and wishing you all the best. Thanks for being here, and thanks for listening today. Thank you. Bye.